to the First Congregational United Church of Christ here in Grand Junction, Colorado. I guess I can take that mask off now. We are delighted to have each and every one of you with us today, whether in person or through pre-recorded worship. We're glad you choose to be a part of us and spend the time with us today. First Congregational is an open, welcoming, affirming congregation. We include everyone, no exceptions. And to remind ourselves of that commitment, we say together every Sunday morning, whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. A couple of announcements before we begin our worship this morning. The first is just a huge word of thanks to all of those who participated in ShareFest yesterday morning. We had what I thought was a terrific response from the congregation. I think about 15 folks, and we did two fairly major projects. We actually have another one on the boards for later this week, being done with some folks and by some folks who couldn't be here yesterday morning. So we thank all of those who came out and helped out those in the community who aren't able to do their own yard work and those kind of things. I also just want to give a special word of thanks this morning to Sally Sue Shell, or as I call her, SQ. She does just a remarkable job in general with mission and outreach, but the amount of time and energy she has put into ShareFest, going to the monthly meetings and organizing everything, way beyond expectation, just an awesome job. So I think we don't do this often, but I think we will. Thank you, Seth. Secondly, we will continue this morning our dialogue and feedback time after worship. So as we did last week, we'll take about a 5-minute break after the worship service is over. For those who need to leave or just to take a stretch to use the facilities, and then we'll come back together for those who would like to and have some conversation about the subject matter of the day. Let's now begin our worship.
Please join me in the call to worship, which is based on Psalm 51, verses 1 through 10 from the Message Bible. Generous in love, God, give grace. Huge in mercy, wipe out my bad record. Scrub away my guilt. Soak out my sins in your laundry. I know how bad I've been. My sin are staring me down. You're the one I violated, and you've seen it all, seen the full extent of my evil. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. I've been out of step with you for a long time, in the wrong since the very beginning. What you're after is truth from the inside out. Enter me then. Conceive a new, true life. So begin your laundry, and I'll come out clean. Cleanse me, and I'll have a snow white life. Tune me into foot-tapping songs, O God. Set these once broken bones to dancing. Don't look too close with blemishes. Give me a clean bill of health. God, make a fresh start in me. Shape a new beginning from the chaos of my life. Into your hands, O God, I commit my life. Use me, please, for good.
According to the working of his great power. and choose to for the reading of our second scripture lesson. And before I read the second lesson, I just want to make a couple of comments about the scripture passages of the day. Both of these passages are about the church in Ephesus. The one that Andrea just read a moment ago was written by the Apostle Paul in all likelihood, and probably written around 50 AD, fairly early in the life of the church. The second one that I'm about to read is from the Revelation of John, was written much later, probably 50, maybe even 70 years later than the one in Ephesians 1. So what I want you to do is to listen to and compare those two. They're written in your bulletin, so you can take a look at them, and see what has changed, and see why I have selected these for today's scripture readings. I'm not going to say one word about these readings in my sermon this morning. Not one word. So for those of you who are going to stay afterward for the feedback session, one of the questions I'm going to ask you is, why do you think I selected those passages? Here again, the Word of God, from Revelation 2, selected verses. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance. I know that you cannot tolerate evildoers. You have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them to be false. I also know that you are enduring patiently and bearing up for the sake of my name, and that you have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then from what you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let's pray together. Good and gracious God, may the words that I speak, may the thoughts and insights of our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight, you who are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In last week's message, we took a look at the church worldwide, the global church, and took a look at how it is doing. And the general answer, the high overview level answer is, it's doing quite well. The church is growing significantly in many parts of the world. Today we're going to focus in, and we're going to begin to look at the church in North America and see how it is doing and how it compares to the church around the world. So let's start with the good news. In the last century, that would be 1900 to 2000, the church in North America, the Christian church in North America, has actually grown. That's good news. It's grown by about 0.8% on the average year. We compare that with the fact that over that same period of 100 years, the population of North America has grown by an average of about 1.2% a year. So you can see that although the Christian church is growing numerically, every year it's becoming a little smaller percentage of the population of this country. So let's dig a little deeper into that. Look at it in a little more detail. You may have noticed that there is a chart on the third or fourth page of your bulletin, a graphic that will give you some idea of some of the information I'm going to share. And it comes to us from the World Christian Database, which is a respected source of information, data related to churches around the world. When they look at big picture, not just in the United States, but also all the other continents, they divide Christianity into six major segments, or six major groups. So we have Anglican, we have Independent, Marginal, Orthodox, Protestant, and Roman Catholic. Those are the six categories that they use. So which of those six do you think in North America grew the most quickly in the 20th century? You can look at your little chart and you can figure it out, although the chart is indeed very little. It's hard to see. I was surprised to learn that the church, the segment that grew the quickest in that century in North America, is the Orthodox Church. That surprised me. And I think a lot of that has to do with immigration and people coming in the last century from places where they were either oppressed or where they did not have full religious freedom. Keep in mind also that although it grew by an average of 3% each year over the course of 100 years, it's still a very small number. It's still a small percentage of the population. But that was the largest growing segment, the Orthodox Church. So who comes next? Two other groups that also defied the odds and grew faster than the population grew. The independent churches and the marginal churches. Now, I think most of us know what the independent church is, right? You just drive up and down the streets of Grand Junction. You see them on almost every corner. They're everywhere. They are Christian churches that basically are not a part of any other larger group. They're not affiliated with any denomination. They're, as they say, independent. They're on their own. They're not tied to anyone else. So we understand what those folks are about. And they have grown significantly, 2.8%, so more than double the rate of population growth. They have grown. The same can be said for the marginal churches. Now, whenever I hear that term marginal church, it sounds kind of pejorative to me. And one of you asked me before the service, what the heck is the marginal church? Well, marginal churches are those churches that identify as Christian, but do not follow all of the tenets of orthodoxy, do not conform completely with other Christian churches. So some examples of what we might identify as marginal churches are Church of Jesus Christ of the Latter-day Saints, Jehovah's Witnesses, Quakers, okay, Christian Scientists. Each one of them has some aspect of their belief system that doesn't conform with kind of mainstream Orthodox Christianity. So they certainly identify as Christian and they are counted as Christian. But they are in this separate category because for some at least they are seen as kind of outliers because of their non-conforming beliefs. Now, it's important to say, having said that, two things. One, those groups are growing, and they're growing quickly. They're growing at 2.8% a year. Again, more than double the growth of the population in this country. The other thing to point out is that these groups are not necessarily conservative or liberal. They run the spectrum. They cannot be lumped into a particular category in terms of where they're coming from. Okay? So So that leaves one other church, one other Christian church in North America that has beat the odds in the 20th century, that grew faster than the population. And which one was that? The Roman Catholic Church. Despite all of the scandals that have surrounded the Roman Catholic Church related to the behavior of priests, and despite the fact that there is a lot of disagreement within the Catholic community in North America around a lot of their principal doctrines, things like birth control, abortion, the infallibility of the Pope, the role of women in the church, these are all areas in which different Catholics disagree with each other, especially here in North America. But nonetheless, they have grown faster than the population. Now, why do you think that is? Any ideas? It can be summed up in one word. Close, yes. Hispanics. Okay? Hispanics. 71% of all the growth that has taken place in the Roman Catholic Church in North America over the last 50 years has been a result of Hispanics, both because they have immigrated into this country in significant numbers, and of course because their birth rates tend to be significantly higher than the Caucasian population. So who do we have left? We've got the Anglicans, and we've got the Protestants. And the good news is that over the course of the 20th century, Protestantism actually did grow in this country by 0.6%. Now, that's not a huge growth rate, and it's much slower than the population growth. And the other thing to remember is that includes an entire century, 1900 to 2000. And most of us here today are old enough to remember when we were going to church in the 1950s and 1960s. What did the white Protestant church look like in those days? Well, it looked white, yes, for sure. But if your church was anything like my church in the 1950s and 60s, it was packed. There were tons of people, and there were families. And that began to change rather quickly and precipitously in the 1970s. And every decade since, we have seen that level of growth accelerate. The growth in decline, that is, accelerate. And we don't need tests or data to know that. We can just look around and remember what the pews looked like then and now. From the year 1990 to the year 2014, the average white Protestant church decreased by one-third. So if there were 300 people worshiping in 1990, there were 200 people worshiping in 2014. And it's only going to get worse from there. Now, why do I say it's going to get worse? Because right now, 20% of the population in the U.S. is individuals between the ages of 18 and 34. Okay? 20% of the population. There's only one white Protestant church in 10 that has that demographic, that age group, represented as 20% or more of their church membership. So young people are dropping away from church even more quickly than those who are older. So that's a challenging message, isn't it? And most of us here, many of us here at least, have lived that experience. We've been in the church and we've seen that happen. We may not have been aware of the specific numbers that I've quoted you, but we knew what the general trend was. And one of the major results of that has been depression, grieving, a sense of loss. Lauren Mead wrote a book called The Once and Future Church. It's where I stole the title for this sermon series. And in his book, The Once and Future Church, he compares the grieving experience that the church is going through right now, especially mainline white Protestant churches, to the stages of grief that Elizabeth Kubler-Ross presented in her book On Death and Dying. Probably most of you read that book at some point, and you remember those five categories that she set up of the process that most churches go through. One is denial. Two is depression. Three is bargaining. Four is anger. And hopefully, five is acceptance. So Lauren Mead talks about how our churches today are going through each of those phases. Let's take a look at each one of them quickly and have at least some sense of what he's talking about. So we start with denial. Churches are in denial when they look at their numbers every year. Their attendance numbers, their membership numbers, their financial numbers, and they see them going down, not just year after year, but decade after decade. And they may even talk about it, but they don't really do anything about it. They don't behave any differently. It doesn't change the way they do ministry. Denial is when churches dig into their reserves every year to balance the budget, but don't have a game plan for adjusting or turning that around. Denial is when churches defer maintenance on their facilities and just kind of hope that somehow eventually things will get better or that the next generation will take care of it. Denial also exists when pastors and denominational executives see the trends, see what is going on, but don't really do anything different. Maybe they work a little harder, maybe they push a little harder, but they don't change the focus of what they do or the way they do ministry. And one other example of denial that Lorne Mead gives is when churches that are shrinking decide to merge with another church that is shrinking, thinking that that will solve the problem. The reality is each church is a very unique culture, and the record on this is very poor. Mergers almost never work. They almost always result in the failure of both of the churches. That's denial. Depression is also one of the byproducts of grieving. What does that look like in the church? A loss of energy, a lack of enthusiasm, an unwillingness to try new things. A hope that things will get better, but not being willing to step forward and do what needs to be done. Those are all signs of depression. For pastors, it's often just holding on with their fingernails, hoping they're going to make it till retirement. And then there's bargaining. You know what bargaining is? anything better, God, if we just do this one thing. So for the church, some of the things we think will save us and we use as a bargaining chip are things like, let's try a new hymnal. Let's do a new outreach program. Let's change our style of worship. Maybe if we go contemporary, that will solve our problems. Maybe if we get a new and better pastor, maybe that'll solve our problems. Maybe if we can just find the right gal or the right guy, and they stick around for a while, everything will be okay. And then there's anger. Anger is almost always a part of the grieving process. And Meek would say that that's true in the church as well. And I would agree with him. He talks about dealing with tough issues in the church. Issues about belief systems, social justice issues, the role of women, LGBTQ issues, immigration issues. These are all legitimate issues that the church has to address, and it can be challenging. And in most places, probably, there are going to be parties on both sides of the issue. But what Mead would maintain is that because the churches are so tired and depleted, and because they have been dealing in a challenging context for so long, they don't deal with these issues in a positive way, in a constructive way. They don't listen to one another and seek resolution. They get angry. They yell. They scream. They accuse each other of having ulterior motives. And the result is that either the church splits or it is greatly reduced in its health, in its capacity to do ministry. Another place where anger manifests itself pretty easily and pretty consistently these days is in anger directed toward clergy. Clergy often become the scapegoat. I'm not sure if you have read the statistics on this, but it's staggering. Clergy are being fired from their jobs at a rate that has never, ever been seen before in this country. If the church has a problem, all too often, the pastor is identified as the problem. Now again, understand, pastors make mistakes, pastors do things wrong. But what Mead would say is, often the church has a lot of anger and frustration to deal with, the pastor becomes a convenient focus for that anger. And then finally we have acceptance. So what does acceptance look like? Well, very simply, it looks the same as it does when a person is dying. And that is accepting the reality that life is ending. For the church in North America, and particularly for the white Protestant church in North America, that means understanding that the church as we have known it, as it has existed in our lifetimes, is dying. That's a fact. That's what's happening. And all of our efforts to tinker around the edges and fix things in that way are simply not going to work. The church must be born again. It must be re-envisioned in a whole new mindset, a whole new way of being, whole new manner of doing things. You probably remember that old line, the definition of insanity is continuing to do the same things and expect expecting a different result. That's sort of where the church in North America is today. Doing the same things is no longer the future. We need a new way. We need a new beginning. We need a new vision of what it means to be church. And you'll be happy to know that in sessions 3, 4, and 5, we're going to talk about that and what that might look like. So I think that will give all of you who decide to stay for the feedback session something to talk about and something to chew on. In the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, amen. As God has blessed us, we now take opportunity to bring our gifts to God. And as we have been doing throughout this season of COVID, we invite you to come forward, place your gift in the offering plate. Do that by the center aisle, and then please return to your seats by the side.
Started physical therapy this past week, and she's hopeful that that's going to help. So continue prayers and support for her and the others. Be most welcome. If you have anyone you would like us to pray for or anything you would like us to pray for, there's a mic here in the front. Would you just please come down to the front and share your request, and please first share your name. Anyone have a prayer request? Carolyn Ramsey.
Growing up, there were three of us and my cousins, there were three then. My aunt and uncle are gone. One of the cousins has died about 6 months ago. The second boy is dying now, and I'm asking for prayers for my cousin. She's totally all alone with no family, and she lives in New Jersey, so that's an added problem. Thank you.
So Carolyn is asking prayers for her cousin who lives in New Jersey and is finding herself without a support system. Thank you, Carolyn. Anyone else? And you?
I'd like to ask for prayers for Gary Nevin's family. Gary passed away Monday unexpectedly. Also for Drew's father, James, who died Tuesday unexpectedly. And for my niece and nephew's grandma, who passed away Thursday.
Thank you, Ken. That's a lot. Anyone else? We're going to do something quite different for our prayers of the people time this morning. Those of you who are followers of Richard Rohr, the Center of Action and Contemplation, know that on this past Tuesday, after the verdict came down in the trial of Derek Chauvin regarding the death of George Floyd, Richard Rohr wrote a prayer. It's a simple prayer, a brief prayer, a powerful prayer. And so as we focus around the continuing violence in this country, especially directed toward blacks and people of color, we want to focus on that prayer this morning. I'm going to read it through three times. And we're going to take a little hint from Lectio Divina, if any of you are familiar with that. And the first time I read it to you, I want you to focus on your head and ask yourself, what is Richard Rohr saying in this prayer, and what does it mean? The second time I read it through, I want you to focus from your heart. How has this prayer touched me? What difference does it make in how I feel about life or feel about this situation? And then the third time I read it through, I'd like you to focus on your will, on your volition, and ask yourself, how has my life changed because of this situation? How, if at all, am I going to do things differently because of this outcome? And then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let us pray together. Focusing first with our heads. God of truth, we thank you today for the justice of this moment and the judgment according to your will. You have again inspired action that brought down the arrogant and called the powerful to account. May this give all people hope for our healing. Together. May you free us from our need for vengeance and clear the field to be ready for new speed. And this time with your hearts. God of truth, we thank you today for the justice of this moment and a judgment according to your will. You have again inspired action that brought down the arrogant and called the powerful to account. May this give all people hope for our healing together. May you free us from our need for vengeance and clear the field to be ready for new speed. And then, with your will, God of truth, we thank you today for the justice of this moment and a judgment according to your will. You have again inspired action that brought down the arrogant and called the powerful to account. May this give all people hope for our healing together. May you free us from our need for vengeance and clear the field to be ready for new speed. And we bring these prayers in the name of the Christ, who invites us to pray together. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Before Lexi sings the last song, I know that for the postlude, you're used to sitting back down and having a little mini concert that you sometimes applaud after. And I'm going to ask that we take a clue from Pastor David today and do something different. Instead of sitting back down, would you stand up and move and greet the spirit in each other in whatever way your body leads you to do, because it's going to be a moving song.
Transform, renew.
Please stand as you are able for the benediction. And now as you go forth from this place, recommitting yourselves to be the light of Christ, the good news of the gospel, vehicles of grace in God's world. May the Lord God bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May she lift up her countenance upon you, granting you this day